Doctor Who, Meglos, by Terrance Dix. Read by John Culshaw. Chapter 1. Abduction of an Earthling. People disappear. There's nothing illegal about walking out of your old life, changing your name, getting another job in another town or another country. Sometimes there may be a more sinister explanation. In criminal circles, people have been known to drop out of sight and never reappear. There are rumors that the concrete pilings that support some of our new motorways are hiding grisly secrets. Even in a small country like England, there are wild stretches where a body can be hidden and never found. Some disappearances have far stranger explanations. Like the disappearance of George Morris. Mr. Morris was an assistant bank manager in a small country town. Tall, slim, with horn-rimmed glasses and a pleasant open face. He was about as average a specimen of his kind as you could wish to find. He was fortunate in that he lived close to his work. Most days he didn't even take the car. 20 minutes brisk walking across the common took him from the front door of the little high street bank, across a pleasantly wild and unspoiled common, and up to the front door of the big house in a quiet country lane. On this particular evening, he telephoned his wife just before he left the bank and told her, as he told her every weekday evening, that he would be home in 20 minutes. Mrs. Morris said, "Yes, dear," went to the drinks cabinet and poured him a glass of medium dry sherry. 20 minutes later, she would hear his key in the lock. Sometimes she found herself wishing George would be a little less predictable. As it happened, George Morris's life was about to become very unpredictable indeed. He strode briskly out of the town, across the common, and followed his usual path, which led through a clump of trees, down into the little hollow, and then on home. It was a fine summer evening. He wasn't taking work home, so he was quite unencumbered. No raincoat, no brolly, not even a briefcase, as he marched smartly through the green countryside, a faintly incongruous figure in his dark business suit. At the top of the little hollow, he stopped in utter astonishment. There was a square metal shape squatting there in the centre of the hollow. At close range, it looked enormous, the size of a small building. It seemed to be made of heavy steel plates, scarred and pitted with rust. Morris walked cautiously up to it. There was a clanking, grinding sound, and a door slid open in the side. A group of men came out, extraordinary men in wild, barbaric, vaguely military-looking clothes. The leader was big-bellied and bearded, with cunning little eyes and a piggy face. The man behind him was taller, with a stubble of grey beard on his chin. More men appeared, tough, savage-looking types, with oddly shaped weapons in their belts. To Morris's indignation, two of them darted round behind him, gripping his arms. He struggled wildly, but he found he was quite helpless. "What's going on?" he demanded indignantly. "Is this some kind of student rag?" No one answered. The burly, bearded one, obviously the leader, studied Morris thoughtfully, as if checking him off against some mental specification. Then he nodded. The tall, thin one took a small silver cylinder from his pocket and pressed it to Morris's neck. Immediately, Morris became quiet and still. He was more or less asleep on his feet as they led him into the spaceship. Slowly, lumberingly, the ship took off. It gathered speed, dwindling rapidly. It shot up into the summer sky, then vanished completely as it entered hyperspace. Morris remained under electronic sedation for the long voyage across the galaxy. It was when he awoke that the nightmare really began. As it happened, the kidnapper's spacecraft was converging with another, even more extraordinary ship. A space-time craft in the form of a square blue box with a flashing light on top. A police box of a type used on Earth in the 20th century. It was called the TARDIS, and it was the property, or at least it was currently in the possession of, a wandering renegade Time Lord, known as the Doctor. The TARDIS had many unusual features. Among them, that of being dimensionally transcendental. Small on the outside, infinitely larger on the inside. In the brightly lit central control room of the TARDIS, the Doctor was hard at work. At this time in his lives, he was a very tall man with wide, staring eyes and a mop of curly hair. Much of the time he wore a long, elegant coat, something between overcoat and smoking jacket, made of some reddish, velvety material, and cut in a vaguely Edwardian style. Just now the Doctor was in his shirt sleeves and wearing an apron round his waist. The coat, together with an incredibly long multicoloured scarf and a broad-brimmed soft hat, were hanging on an old-fashioned coat stand that looked strangely out of place in the control room. At this particular moment, the Doctor wasn't actually controlling the TARDIS. He was leaving this to his Time Lady companion, Romana, a fair-haired, classically good-looking young woman with an impressively high forehead and an air of aristocratic hauteur. Romana had a great sense of her own dignity, which sometimes suffered in her association with the Doctor. The task presently occupying the Doctor was the repair of K9, who had been temporarily immobilized by a rash dip in the sea. In appearance a kind of robot dog, K9, as he would be the first to tell you when in good health, was a self-powered mobile computer with defense capabilities. If anything, the little automaton had an even greater sense of dignity than Romana. For the time being, however, K9 was lying mute and immobile on a table, his circuits corroded by brine. The Doctor, who loved a good tinker, was happily working away at K9's innards with his sonic screwdriver, leaving Romana in charge of the many-sided central control console. The Doctor worked absorbedly for some time, occasionally muttering to himself odd disjointed phrases like, "Aha, that's it," and "Where did I put those electro pliers?" In between times, he whistled an old Martian lullaby between his teeth. For some reason, Romana found all this very irritating. She moved around the console, adjusting controls and checking dials, shooting the Doctor an occasional glance of irritation. At last, the Doctor looked up.
"Nearly there, Romana. This is the delicate bit. You'd better stop the TARDIS. We don't want any nasty jolts."
Romana studied the navigational console. "We seem to be in the Prion planetary system at the moment. We'd better land." The Doctor frowned. The Prion planetary system sounded vaguely familiar, but he couldn't remember whether that was familiar good or bad.
"Never mind. Hovering will do."
As always, Romana felt her way was best.
"You're sure, Doctor? There's a planet called Tigella that looks quite handy."
The Doctor was brooding over K9 circuits.
"Tigella? Never heard of it."
"Well, there's one called Zolfathura as well. You must have heard of that. It's in all the history books."
"They're all in someone's history books. What's so special about Zolfathura?"
"A great technological civilization. Supposed to have made incredible breakthroughs in energy matrix technology. Destroyed itself in some mysterious internal war. A whole great civilization blown away to sand and ashes. Now all that's left is the screens."
"Quite. What screens?"
"Enormous metal screens. 5 of them, set up on the surface of the planet for some long-forgotten purpose. The screens of Zolfathura."
"Oh, those screens."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.